So, Hector, your turn.
Thank you. So, hello everybody. My name is Hector Romojaro. I'm here with Antonio Pisano and Marcus Moser out there. All of us are from the LearnAt BU team inside the Vienna University of Economics and Business. Our main task in the university is to take care of the LearnAt BU platform, which is basically an e-learning platform made basically in TCL. So it's based on OpenACS plus NaviServer, which some of you may know. I will talk about it later a bit. And it's a project started in 2002, designed for scalability. We have currently, it's one of the most extensively used e-learning platforms in higher education. And there is some numbers out here. We have 15 million hits, 3.3 million page impressions every day, blah, 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 2,500 concurrent users, and so on. Yes, oh, thanks. Here, here, ah, very good. The platform itself is based not only in content, but also on exercises, learning resources, learning analytics, and so on. And we have all these numbers come from a single OpenACS instance with a single NaviServer instance. So NaviServer and OpenACS, for those of you who are not familiar with them, NaviServer is a web server, programmer web server programmed in TCL and C. It started as a fork of OWL Server 4.10 with some later backports of OWL Server 4.5 and so on, and its own development during all these years. It's currently quite active. The last version is from January this year. And it provides with some really useful modules. I'm only saying, putting here a couple of them, because they are of interest for us, such as NSDBPG. We have a PostgreSQL database below NaviServer and OpenACS. We use the rep proxy module and the WebSocket. We will explain later on what we use them for, but basically you can imagine. On top of this, we have OpenACS, a TCL-based toolkit for scalable community-oriented web applications, whatever all this means. Basically a community application that we use as the base of our learning platform. It was born in the 90s in the now extinct Ars Digita. After Ars Digita was bought by Red Hat and the project was more or less abandoned, sort of, so to say, some parts of the people who were working in Ars Digita started maintaining it inside the community as free software, as well as NaviServer is free software as well. I didn't mention it. But the point of this talk is not the community, the platform itself, but the Lecturecast project, which is basically, just imagine, we are currently maintaining this this e-learning platform, and suddenly, okay, we should probably start basically recording and streaming lectures. This is a nice thing to do as a university in general. So how hard can it be, right? Just recording a lecture and streaming it and should be fine. So the goal was to equip 12 lecture halls inside the university with cameras and encoders for both cameras and the PC. We wanted to not only be able to record and stream the camera, but also the interaction in the PC. Not only the slides, but the whole thing, because we have very creative lecturers, and they not only want to show slides, but maybe play videos, maybe open a browser and start looking up things. So we don't want this to be lost. And in the end, this is sort of, so we already have 12 lecture halls equipped. So we have two streams per room, per lecture hall. This is, in the end, 24 streams that we have to take care of. But this is not true, as we will see afterwards, because there will be some extra resolutions that we need to generate via transcoding and so on. We want also to provide with room-to-room streaming. Sometimes it happens that some lectures are so popular, maybe the beginning of the courses in the Audimax or things like that, that are so overcrowded that we need extra rooms to put students in and watch the lecture. So we provide these rooms with decoders as well, so we can have a couple of extra rooms. So this is not lost. And as I mentioned before, we want to have two streams, video and the PC. For this, we need a video player capable of managing these two streams. It's possible to generate a composed image or composed video of these two streams, but it's sort of awkward because you cannot change the size of one of the, if you want to read the slides, maybe it's too small, you know. We want also this player to be mobile friendly. This means a lot of things. Not only compatibility, but also adaptive bitrate. I will talk about this later on. But yeah, basically, adaptive bitrate allows you to have multiple resolutions for a simple video. And depending on your network quality or your device, this would be selected, more or less, or played automatically by the client. So you are watching a video in a very small tablet or very small smartphone in a very, very bad Wi-Fi network. And then suddenly you're watching it automatically in 360p, for instance, instead of the 1080p native one. Another thing we wanted to do is to have an online video editor also capable of editing these two streams or these two videos that also need to be in sync. I mean, it doesn't make sense to have two different streams, but with 10 seconds difference between each other, so it's a bit tricky. In the end, we did this online video editor ourselves. We'll explain a bit of the internals afterwards, but I think it's interesting. We want also to have a sort of a cockpit or video recording or recording administration interface for the lecturer to be able to start, stop the recordings, and have some nice preview of the video and the audio, if possible, with some waveforms. And these previews will have very low latency, so otherwise, if the lecturer tests the microphone and doesn't see anything moving, and 10 seconds later he sees something moving, this will not work. And of course, GDPR compliant, as everybody already can imagine. But most importantly, we want to integrate all of these things and control them from the Learn platform itself, meaning we're going to do this mostly in TCL on the server side. So some technical requirements, I already talked about some of these. Of course, there's this web-based user interface. The preview will be generated. We have at most a 2 second delay. It has to be scalable for all the amount of rooms, users, and so on. Device compatibility, blah, blah, blah. And some of the technologies that we chose to do this are for the preview. We chose to make an MJPEG preview, which is enough for what we need, and it's easy computationally talking or quick to generate. I mean, you don't need to really, you need too much horsepower as to generate a whole transcoding of 1080p video into whatever to generate an MJPEG preview with some frame rate of, I don't know, 10 frames per second or something like that. Should be quick. As the recording format and also as the streaming format, we use the HLS protocol, which is bandwidth efficient, pro support, live streaming, and it has some interesting, let's say, design decisions that we could exploit for the video editor itself. I will explain this later, but basically, the HLS, you have a video in HLS, you have basically two elements, two components. You have one playlist, in M3 U8 format, and video segments. So if you make these video segments small enough, let's say some seconds, it's possible to just edit, cut, paste, move around pieces of the video with just modifying the playlist. I spoiled a bit of this, but anyway. So we want to provide with more resolutions than the native resolution provided by the original hardware encoders that are attached to both the laptop or the lecture's PC and the camera. And for this, we need a transcoding infrastructure. I mean, in the end, transcoding is a computationally expensive operation. It's not so easy. If you want to have something really working in parallel with all, in the best case, with all the streams being transcoded at the same time. So this is a diagram of the setup for one of the rooms. We have the camera, present the PC. We have this small control cockpit, which is basically a touch screen with some embedded Linux box to control the with a browser interface. This receives the MJPEG preview with as integrated in the web interface, and we have a transcoder for every single stream, a physical transcoder for every single stream. I will talk about the transcoder cluster later, and then we have the NaviServer and OpenACS recording, web broadcasting, whatever server, which will be more or less the brain of all of this. This is a graph of basically the whole thing with the 12 rooms. And this is the architecture. So in order to be able to take care of all this process, we have to divide it in phases, more or less. We have the retrieval phase, which is not so interesting. We have cameras, encoders, and so on. These encoders produce 1080p UDP multicast streams. Then we have the transcoding cluster, which is composed of several small devices doing one transcoding, or transcoding one stream at a time, and producing also the MJPEG preview for the recording admin interface. And then we have the more or less the more related TCL-based stuff with the Lecturecast server and the Learn platform. The Lecturecast server takes takes care of the recording of the streams, which is done via network. So the Lecturecast server takes from the network the streams that want to be recorded and blah blah blah. It also integrates with the Learn system, and it has its own NaviServer plus OpenACS instance to provide with the logic for all of this. We have also the video player I was talking about before. We're using the Paella player, which is made in the university, in the Universitat Politécnica de Valencia in Spain. And the main point of the player is, as I said before, it's capable of playing two streams in parallel, and it's fancy. I mean, you can increase one of them and decrease the other one and have the two of them. And so you want to see more of the slides, you want to see less of the lecture, it's possible. It's also part of the OpenCast project, which I would like to talk a bit here, because it's a project composed of several institutions working together with tools for lecture casting in general, and this is a really important project. We're only using this particular piece of that project, but they have some fancy things. Of course, the player is capable of doing HLS and playing multiple resolutions with adaptive bitrate, so you can see in your phone in a very bad networking, or you can see it on a fancy 1080p monitor, whatever fancy 1080p right now is. This is the actual status of the recording admin interface. These are the two previews from the we talked about, this MJPEG generated previews. It is quite simple. It has a quite simple interface with just an audio preview here and the two video previews of the two streams, and it has a server-side interaction with the backend and the transcoding cluster itself. So I talked a bit about this. I think I really spoiled the whole point of the online video editor. But whatever. The point of the video editor is basically we want to be able to edit quickly, web-based, the videos after they're produced. So sometimes the lecturer just doesn't want some part of the video to be in the final recording, or sometimes, yeah, you can imagine. And also, we don't want to store different copies of the same video in the end, or different varieties of the same video. We just want to store one copy, because in the end, if the system is widely used, space is limited, and videos are big. So this simple video editor should allow us to move, delete, and add segments, and maybe generate views of the same video. That can be introduced in the learning, materials or the learning activities, and so on. So one lecturer decides, oh, I want this particular piece of 10 minutes of this particular lecture here in this particular content, so the students can because it's relevant to the topic or whatever. So we want to avoid transcoding, as this is a very expensive operation in the end. For this, we're talking about this as an operation that is made after the video is originally transcoded. So we don't want to transcode it again. We don't want to generate new videos again. We don't want to, if possible, because it's also a bit slower. So modifying the video segments I was talking before, I mean, if the video segments, what we call this video segment size, we're doing right now about 6 seconds each segment. If we want to increase the resolution, the time resolution of the segments in order to cut more than this, we can make it up to 1 second, for instance, choosing the proper group of picture size. So 18 in the end is just modifying the playlist, which is a file. So it's sort of trivial. And it can be done in real time, so we can see the changes in the web editor and so on. This is still work in progress. The whole project is still work in progress. The deadline is mid-September. So it should be ready for Oktoberfest if you want to, I don't know, just saying. But the video editor currently is capable of doing all of this. It's not that much. So we have to polish the interface before showing it, maybe. And this also works for all the supported resolutions. I mean, having the same video segment size allows us to keep in sync both the slides and the video from the camera if we want to cut apart or put, you know, the whole thing. And this is the system sequence diagram. For this, I will ask Antonio to continue because he's more, he will do a better insight on this part, and it will be more TCL related, actually. There will be some TCL code examples here about the use of WebSockets, reverse proxy module, and so on. I think we're still OK in time. So, yeah.
Hello everyone. So we had a look about the high-level features of this Lecturecast system. This is this is the system sequence diagram. As you can see, during the Lecturecast system operations, we have basically four components. which are actually hardware components. So there is the lecturer's device. There is, of course, the learn platform, the Lecturecast server, which acts as a backend, headless backend. And then there is the encoder box in the transcoding cluster. The lecturer's device will ask to the learn platform the web page composing the user interface and receive some information. And from then on, the user interface will start dialogating with the Lecturecast server, which in turn will pass the proper messages to the encoder boxes. At the end of the whole operation, the Lecturecast server will take care of collecting the recorded stream and sending it to the learn platform. This is the class diagram of the backend, so the Lecturecast server. This video recorder class is a singleton class, which takes care of collecting and maintaining a list of streams, which are defined by the room name and the device name. So room name is the internal name we assign to every room in the campus, and device name might be either camera or PC. Every stream can be associated to a particular recording, which is also managed by the video recorder. Recording consists of different operations, such as the physical interaction with the stream and the FFmpeg commands that compose the actual recording. The implementation was done exploiting a very interesting property of the OpenACS platform, which is a powerful object relational mapping. Classes can be defined declaratively without explicitly specifying the data model or writing SQL, only by writing TCL code. And then incremental changes. So for example, in case new columns are added or new constraints are added, this doesn't need an explicit upgrade logics. It's just sufficient to add a column in the code and the machinery will take care of updating the data model. The typical CRUD operations, such as, for example, the creation, the reading, etc., the deletion, come for free, so to say, because they are inherited from the generic object that is the ACS object. Most importantly, tables are still there to be queried when needed. So all of this powerful machinery won't prevent the developer from touching the real SQL. This is an example of class definition. Here we define the stream class. As you can see, it's composed of various attributes. I don't know if they are all readable, but anyhow, there are the video preview URL, the audio preview URL, the device name, the room name, etc. Here is an example of class instantiation. As you can see, it's very simple. We just create an object, we assign the properties, and then we save it. That's it. Of course, methods can be extended. This is the normal save operation, which is extended by a method requiring the previews to be generated, and then passing to, this is more or less equivalent to the super construct in the Java language, for example. Lecturecast server is a pure backend, therefore it's completely headless and doesn't have a user interface. For this purpose, the OpenACS platform defines an interesting class called the protocol handler, which is basically a way to attach a class to a URL that is explicitly defined. And for example, it can be specified to react to the various HTTP methods such as post, get, put, head, etc. At Vue, we use it also for implementing webdav and caldav. But in this case, it was used to create a very clean backend, so to say. This is the video recorder implemented as a protocol handler and associated to the URL video recorder. And then here we say, long story short, we say whenever somebody is sending you a method starting with www, associate it with a method with the same name. For example, add recording. This is the method answering to this URL. It's very simple, doesn't require trivial headless pages to be defined. It's all in the TCL. The front-end backend communication presents some challenges. For example, the backend receives continuous updates about status of recording the system in general, and these updates must be communicated in possibly in real time with the user interface. Therefore, a real-time push notification is a requirement. The solution was to employ the NaviServer module WebSocket, present since version 4.99.7. This module basically takes the incoming connection, associates it with a background thread, and then releases the connection thread in a way it can serve new clients immediately. I don't know how much you can read about this, but as you can see, probably, this is here we call the WebSocket API with the channel name, and this is the whole interaction, more or less. And here is just a piece of JavaScript code interacting with the WebSocket. Another challenge is that the user interface is actually composed by the output of three MJPEG previews, so the two video preview and the audio preview coming from the transcoding cluster, and two WebSockets coming from the Lecturecast server. So there are two machines giving us the data we need for the user interface, and five connections. In order for all of these to be HTTPS compliant, all of these connections must be HTTPS. And this presents a very important practical problem, because if we would connect directly to all of these machines, we would need one SSL certificate for each machine in the cluster, which for us is unfeasible. The solution was to employ the NaviServer reverse proxy module, which allows also to use NaviServer as an authentication server, so you can put authentication before your unauthenticated services in the backend. Using the reverse proxy module, basically the user interface will interact always with the learn URL. Therefore, only the certificate we already have will be needed. This is another example of the reverse proxy module. Here we see an important property. So we can define the reverse proxy to happen on the fly. So request by request, we can decide a certain URL must be mapped to another URL. For example, we use this because previews in the cluster might fail because, for example, the cluster node is failing. We can switch on the fly on a fallback preview implementation on the Lecturecast server itself. And this switching happens in real time. But we can also define reverse proxy behavior statically, basically at server startup, by registering a filter, which we'll call the reverse proxy module. Here is some links. So this is our learn platform. This is the OpenACS community. We have the official repository is on CVS, but we have also a GitHub mirror. This is the NaviServer, the NSF and EuroTcl page, and the Paia player. Thanks for watching. And if there are some questions, please.
Any questions? Thank you both for your interesting talk.